Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Bobcast MOB with Rick and Bob, the heartbeat of the Mid-Ohio Valley. I'm your host, Bob Mercer. With me, as always, is my best friend in the whole wide world and the man on the other end of the string in Murphy Town, Mr. Rick Sawyer. Good evening to you, sir.
Good evening.
How you doing?
We're doing wonderful.
Good.
Retirement is good.
Quit rubbing it in. I got two and a half, four years, and I'm done. Here at the Bobcast, we always look for positive things going on in the community. We try to bring on people who are making an impact on the community in a positive way. And first off, we just like to thank everybody for your comments and coming up and saying, hey, you know, we listen to you. We get, people telling us, hey, we watched your Bobcast. It was really good. You know, thank you guys for doing this. Things like that make it worthwhile for what we're doing. Our special guest tonight is going to be Reed Byers, community advocate representing the community, Rural Communities Opioid Response Program. Is that correct, sir?
That is one of our partners for the town hall.
Okay. All right. We'll get to that one then. All right. First off, it's mark your calendar time. We got several to go through. People, and I thank everybody for this. People are sending us more and more every week to come on to the to announce over on the Bobcast. I keep wanting to call it podcast. So mark your calendar for these. Tuesday, August 2nd, 5 to 8 p.m. at the City Park Splash Pad is going to be National Night Out 2022. It's an annual community building campaign that promotes police community partnerships, neighborhood camaraderie to make our neighborhoods safer, more caring places to live. Join the Parkersburg Police Department, Wood County Sheriff's Department for our celebration and National Night Out at the City Park Splash Pad. Other participants will be West Virginia State Police, West Virginia National Guard, members of ambulance squads, fire departments from across the county and the city. Planned displays will include the police department's dare care vehicle, fire department's antique fire engine, Wood County Mobile Command, yay me, plus many, many more exhibits for us and fun for the kids. So come on out, bring your kids to the splash pad, introduce them to police officers, firemen, EMS, and everybody else, and become involved in the community. Thursday, August 4th, 6:30 p.m. at the Rock Church, 1305 37th Street, Parkersburg. It's a Hope For Recovery Townhall. Topic of recovery, resilience, and hope. This will be a panel discussion about the struggle with addiction, hope for recovery, and how this all ties to the community. That's what our guest, Reed Byers, will be speaking about tonight. So I'm not going to go into all that because that's what he's here for. We were hoping to have Wendy Tuck on. Wendy is a District 4 City Councilwoman with me. I'm District 3. She sits right off to my left on the council chambers. She's having a little bit of a technical issue. I'm not sure what's going on. Rick and I are going to find out what happened. So as soon as Reed comes on in a few minutes, we will go ahead and let him talk about that. A lot of things going on. Saturday, August 6th, Parkersburg South High School band's holding tag day at various Southside businesses from 8 to 2. Now, this money is going to be used for these kids to go to Disney. It's going to raise money for their trip. And so go out and support them and you know, let them have some fun. And I don't know if you've all been to some of their performances, some of their shows. They just got back off a grueling week of band camp. My granddaughter is a part of the Color Guard. And my daughter, Erica, her mom, went with them. And they were wore out a whole week. They were wore out by the time they got home. These kids are dedicated to the band, just like the other bands in the community are. So come out next Saturday, 8 to 2, throughout the city, and help them raise their money. All right. We Are, which is a women's ministry summer market, will be held at the Rock Church from 8 to 3, the same day, August 6th, I'm sorry. Convicted Pigs Barbecue will be selling their craft barbecue, breakfast tacos, barbecue meats and sides. Be a small entrance fee, but their website calendar says it's free. Also, on that day from noon to 6, Waverly Volunteer Fire Department's annual ice cream social. We try to get out there every year. And gun raffle at their fire station at 15425 Emerson Avenue. Most of you know it's almost to the county line on Route 2 North. Fraternal Order of Police Lodge 79 is hosting a kids' drug-free picnic at Southwood Park, 6:30 to 8:30. Come out there once again and interact with the police department. Bring your kids out and the family out for some good fun. Monday, August 8th, 5:30 p.m. The Circles Campaign in the Mid-Ohio Valley is hosting an open to the public meeting at St. Joe Landing, which is the old St. Joe Hospital, on recognizing and talking to someone about suicide. Lisa talked to us about that. Lisa talked to us about that last when she was on once before. So we're trying to really push that. Circles is a great organization. And so if you're, you know, we'll get to the volunteer section here in a minute. Let's see where we're at. August 14th, 4 to 6 is the annual Parkersburg Ice Cream Social at the First Baptist Church, corner of 9th and Market. That's a yearly thing that they have. Great fun. We try to go down there too. And they usually have some good stuff set up. So come down, enjoy some ice cream, visit, fellowship, just, you know, very good people. August 16th to the 20th, the Doddridge County Fair. I'm glad you're keeping open to me, Rick. I know you asked me to slow down. Am I doing good enough? I'm sorry.
I'm good, brother. I'm good.
Yeah. All right. So anyway, tickets are $10 at the gate or $25 for non-riding season pass or $35 for a riding season pass, whatever that means. A public forum will be held August 20th, 3 p.m. at the Trinity Episcopal Church Parish Hall on 5th Street in Parkersburg to discuss possible plans for the Sumner School. Rick and I, for the last, well, since we started this, have been touting the Sumner School. This is a major piece of history, folks, right here in the Middle Ohio Valley. You really need to get involved, help these people out. It's just well worth it. They'll be deciding the future of Sumner School, which direction you want to go in. Sumner School was established in 1862. It was the first free black school in the nation south of the Mason-Dixon line. And again, it's right here in our backyard, a big piece of American history. This is kind of something that does and does not pertain to us. My nephew lives up in, Zanesville. Woo! Zanesville, Ohio. And him and his partner bought Redskin's Lane. It's a bowling establishment. Is located at 100 North Washington Street in Utica, Ohio. Be reopening under their ownership very soon. He will send that to me. Just a couple more things. September 17th, 2022, walk to End Alzheimer's at Williamstown Tomlinson Park. Amanda and I did that one time. Amanda and I think the girls were with us. Advanced registration is required. You can then go to our calendar page for contact information. Still, Artsbridge Summer Music at the City Park on Thursday nights at 7 o'clock is going till August. And Parkersburg City Council meets regularly on the 2nd and 4th Tuesdays of each month at 7:30 p.m. in the Council Chambers. Vienna City Council meets at 6 p.m. on the 2nd and 4th Thursday of every month. And the Williamstown City Council meets the 1st and 3rd Tuesday of each month. If you want to get involved in what's going on in your community and you really have a lot you want to say, and you really want to see which direction the city's going in, by all means, come to the city council meetings. We have public forum. Come in and let us know what's on your mind. You know, again, all events that we mentioned on the Bobcast will be posted on the calendar page of our website at thebobcast.net/calendar and in the notes and comments on our YouTube channel. Bear with me. I apologize. Wow. And we've added a new page to our website where we will post informational resources that are available to our community. It's at thebobcast.net/resources. That's going to be, Rick, can you explain that a little bit more of what's going to be on that just real quick?
Yeah, basically right now I've got just a couple of things. I've got suicide prevention on there. That's the new, 988 number. I've got some information on that. I have some information on the circles. For getting out of poverty. And then we're just going to grow that page as we find out other resources to help with whatever people need help with.
Copy. Great. Well, looky there.
There's Wendy.
Looky there. There's Miss Wendy. There is Miss Wendy. Can you hear us okay? Wendy, can you hear us? I don't think our mic's abled. Can you hear us okay? Shake your head. No? Okay. So we're going to go ahead and move on just real quick here. We just have volunteer opportunities. Parkersburg Homecomings, August 19th and 20th of this year. They're in the process of accepting and organizing volunteers for the 2023 season. Again, if you want to become involved in the community, come down and help these people out. They need a lot. That's a big thing, because I told you last week when we discussed this, that once that's over with, they start the next day, and they're starting the next day to start putting things together for next year. They need volunteers. They need people to help them out. The Arc of the Mid-Ohio Valley, SW Resources, and the Circles Campaign in the Mid-Ohio Valley are always looking for qualified volunteers. For more information, go to the volunteer page of our website at www.thebobcast.net. And see if we can, Wendy, can you hear us okay or not? Okay, I think she's stuck, Eric. Hold on, man. Let me back up something. Okay, can you hear us, Wendy? I don't think she can. All right. So, like I said, with us tonight is Mr. Reed Byers. He's going to talk to us about the upcoming, I'm sorry, let me back this up here, the upcoming town hall meeting at the Rock Church at 1305 37th Street, Hope for Recovery Town Hall. And so we're going to have Mr. Reed Byers. We're going to introduce him. He can tell us a little bit about himself. He could tell us, you know, how long he's been doing this stuff. And then he can go into what's going to happen. And if we have any questions, we'll pop it in there and ask him some questions. So, Mr. Byers and Wendy, if you can hear us, thank you both very much for being here. So if you would like, sir, go ahead and tell us a little bit about yourself and tell us about what's going on next week.
Well, thanks for having us today, Bob. It's an honor to be here. It's an honor to be here with Wendy, too. I've been working in the mental health and substance use and youth prevention field for about 2 years now. And I think it's important to mention where I met Wendy first and where I met you first, Bob, was at Parkersburg City Council. It would have been last spring when I was so fortunate to be a part of Healthy Kids Running Series, bringing the first series to West Virginia. And I showed up at council and the mayor had obliged to write a proclamation claiming it is the first West Virginia Healthy Kids Running Series. And I ended up going back to make sure that the mayor and city council was thanked. And ever since, I've just gotten more and more involved in the community, trying to offer input on how the ARPA money can be used and just be an advocate for all things positive in the MOV. Right. So, more specifically about this Hope for Recovery Town Hall, I was at a suicide prevention training several months ago with Wendy, and we had a conversation about one of her neighbors in District 4 who had somebody in the neighborhood storm through her front door, and that person was high on drugs and really terrified her neighbor. And I thought, you know, what an awful situation to be in. You have to be that concerned about the people that are in your neighborhood. But I had the epiphany of people are always going to use substances. If they're in the community, people are going to use them. So as a community, what vision do we have for the people who choose to use substances? Do we need harsher penalties? Do we need harm reduction exchange programs? So I decided, let's have a town hall on the controversial topic often of harm reduction. And Wendy said, I think that's a great idea. Let's make it happen. Absolutely. So that was last spring. And I hadn't really moved forward for a while until Amy Snodgrass, she works for WVU managing the ARCOR grant for our area, which is for opioid response. We're having a training this month, August 3rd and 4th, for regrounding our response. That training is for a curriculum about harm reduction, stigma reduction for substance use, and there's five different topics that people will be getting trained in. And the people that facilitate that training, they're from all over West Virginia, some of them even more abroad, and they'll be coming to Parkersburg to facilitate that training. Some of the topics are adverse childhood experiences, talk about how traumatic childhood experiences can play a role in substance use later in life, or right, the stages of change where, you know, people go through different stages in their recovery from pre-contemplation, contemplation, and then how relapse sometimes can be a part of recovery. So we've got all those trainings, our trainers coming in on August 3rd and 4th, and Amy thought to herself, what a good opportunity to put those people's expertise to use while they're in town and get them engaged in the community. So we picked August 4th. That's this coming Thursday. It'll be the second night of the training, and it'll be before everybody leaves and parts ways. And we've scrambled to throw this thing together in about 4 or 5 weeks, and we've got, you know, a massive following already. It seems like we're going to have a very good turnout. The way that it'll be set up, there'll be three West Virginia natives. Abby is one of of their names. Like, I don't know her last name. Samantha Winland is another participant. And then I'll be on the panel too. We'll be offering our lived and professional experience with addiction. And then Andrew Bell, he's a national substance use and harm reduction expert from the state of Maryland. He's going to be facilitating the conversation. So we'll start offering our personal experience, and then Andrew's going to lead us through a series of questions. And then at the end of the panel, we'll have a large Q&A session where any members of the audience can ask us, or they can ask Andrew, or maybe even they can ask some of the other experts who are going to be in the audience that are part of the trainers for that training to see, you know, what do you guys think about substance use? What's been your experience? What's your perspective? What do you think maybe we could do moving forward? I think we all agree that we're facing challenges with substance use in the Mid-Ohio Valley, and we don't necessarily have the best solutions. Like, we know that there are some solutions available, and I think it's important that we present them, but I think it's even more important that we get the community's feedback on, you know, where are they at with it? How do they feel about it? And are they willing to participate moving forward on these solutions? Because it's not a divisive, it's not a political issue. We need to work together to figure this out. And this is kind of a starting conversation for that.
Well, I know when I first became a city councilman, one of my big things, I was like, and I'm also a 911 dispatcher, you know that. I deal with it every day. And I was like, why is it that if somebody's overdosing on something, they can go in, they Narcan them, and they make them leave? Bob, you can't arrest your way out of this problem. And I sit and thought about that while I was sitting up at the council, and I thought, you know, that makes perfect sense. So we got to figure out how we're going to do this, you know. So in your experience, I mean, what, how many and what type of, well, no, I don't want to say that. Let's go. Let me change that a minute here. I guess where I'm going is that what are you finding are the main, help me out here, Rick. The main causes for people who, I know some people say, you know, it's an illness, and that's, you know, that's fine, you know, that's, but what makes them want to do that first time? Because, you know, I was just listening to a thing today where a 16-year-old boy took a pill that was given to him by this guy he knows. He thought it was OxyContin, and it was fentanyl, and it killed him. So I'm just kind of curious, because I don't know that much about it. And I know this has a lot to do with life things and just stuff like that, and maybe some peer pressure involved, you know. So what's your take on that? I mean, what do you
think? I'll answer that question, and I'll start to put it through a lens. What did your childhood, what did your high school experience look like? What was your college days like, your early adulthood? Think about what that answer would be like from everybody you know.
Right.
It'd be different. Everybody would have their own unique experience.
Exactly. And
it's the same with recovery. Everybody kind of ends up, I think, in drug use in their own individual way. Now, for mine, I can relay my experience and how it started for me. And I think it's probably indicative of a lot of situations for people that are more likely to use substances. So at age 13, I was the last person in my family, my immediate family, to begin using drugs. My mother, bless her heart, my father, my deceased now brother, we lost a heroin overdose, and my sister.
Sorry about that.
Thank you. All of them when I was at the age of 13 were already participating in some form of substance use. You know, mom maybe cocaine, dad alcohol and weed, sister weed. My brother was selling weed at that time. So that was the environment I was raised in. I mean, I'll take responsibility for my choice to use at age 13, and especially afterwards as I became developing as an adult. But I do think that if at age 13 I hadn't been around it for so long and that wasn't the norm, maybe I would have been less likely to use. So you'll hear me time and time again as we talk about substance use and recovery, that I think it's so important we look at the environment that our youth are raised up in, and that's part of the adverse childhood experience training. There's a 10-question questionnaire that gauges, have you been around substance use? Have you been around traumatic experiences, domestic violence, mental illness? And the higher you score to 10 on that, you are much more likely to suffer from a mental illness or substance use in your adult life. So I think a lot of times early on traumatic experience, rough environments where it's more normal to participate in substance use often can be a contributing factor. Now that doesn't explain the kids that are in a different environment that fall into it anyways, it's really unpredictable. But I do think the more turbulent and troublesome the environment at a young age, the more likely an individual is going to be to use later in life. And I think that's something that's really important we look at creating solutions for.
I read something very disturbing just in the last couple of weeks. And that was that on national surveys, they found out that 20% of all teens in America contemplate suicide at least once a day. Now, what in the world has happened to our society where one out of five kids doesn't feel there's anything left to live for? And I'm wondering if perhaps escape into the drug world isn't part of that whole syndrome.
I think
butt in here.
Hey, Wendy, welcome. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, I think I'm good. I think a couple of things. I think COVID certainly had an impact on exacerbating whatever isolation and social lack of social support that the kids already had. But also there's an incredible study called the Adverse Childhood Experiences Study. And that showed, it measured about 10 different factors that contribute to early childhood and distress in general. And what they showed is that any kind of early childhood events, there's a direct correlation between the physical and mental health long-term. So those might be, was there a divorce, a prison, a mental illness, an addiction, any kind of abuse? Did you witness domestic violence? There's, like I said, there's 10 of these factors. And what we're finding is that, you know, the more of those factors a child has, the more at risk they are, not just as kids, but as they get older. And if there's no relief or help or support for them, then it often just does not get better. And kids are it's sometimes hard for them to find a supportive adult. It's hard for them to open up. A lot of people are really ashamed about feeling so desperate and they don't want to talk about it. And I think if adults have a hard time talking about it, kids are going to have a hard time. And it's like the pressure plus the shame plus the inability to talk about it and no safe place. I think those are all factors in, like you say, this is an enormous problem. Thank you for bringing that up, Rick.
Yeah,
it's terrible. Well, how do we intercede at it? You know, how do we catch these kids? How do we get them at a mm-hmm. young age? I know, Wendy, you and I have discussed the youth centers and stuff like that. You know, we discussed that once before when we were talking about some things. But how do we get ahead of this? I mean, you know, we don't want, I knew you can't catch them all, and I understand that, and I'm not saying, you know, but I'm just saying, how can we help make their lives better than, you know, as far as, and the way things are going, I mean, drugs are like inundating the United States of America, and it's pretty sad. I was just telling Reed a little bit ago, I seen a thing where this 16-year-old boy took a pill he thought was OxyContin, and it turned out to be fentanyl and killed him right now. And his parents were on television this morning talking about, we got to do something, people. But, you know, I mean, it takes a community effort, I think, doesn't it, Reed?
Yes, sir.
It takes a community effort to really make this situation better. But I'm just kind of curious where we can, what direction we can head in. And, you know, I wanted to be there Thursday night. I really did, but I'm 5-day quarantine. I can't do anything.
I'm sorry, Bob.
I was just whining, Wendy.
That's okay. It's a big problem. And thank goodness that this workshop is going to be training other people in the community so that we'll be having more of this information out there. So I think that's the fabulous part about training the trainers, so that Reed and Sarah Barton and others that are going to be at this workshop will be resources to us after you get off quarantine. And Reed, I hope you'll address this, because you're one that didn't get caught early, but you did get caught sort of in a different way. and then you were able to turn that around. But I worked for years with birth to three and with early intervention. And I also look at Huntington, and they developed with one of the philanthropic organizations, a very comprehensive, you have to intervene at every stage. Like for me, dealing with infants and children, yes, you saw behavior problems in infants and children, but you also had parents that were traumatized. You had parents that had, their parents were addicted or their parents were abusive. And right. So now you've got the 20-year-old that's trying to mother a three-month-old that has no clue, you know, or their only models were really destructive. So one thing I like about Huntington and what I like about a community approach is that you address it at birth, like Huntington has Lily's Place with the addicted babies. You address it in preschool. You know, you train your teachers to do resiliency skills, and you teach the kids to say no and have good boundaries, and you help them know how to deal with bullies. You know, you deal with your elementary kids and you teach them to set goals, and you have supported adults. You deal with your teenagers, you deal with your young adults, you give job skills, you give training, you support, you encourage, you have healthy recreation, you have you have churches, you know, whatever group can support the family, Boys and Girls Club, Children's Home Society, Children's Listening Place, YMCA. So there you can intervene in all kind of ways with violence prevention, with your young adults. Then you have your young parents. And in Huntington, they have, so we got different levels. You've got the prevention, which is before the child gets involved with drugs, or the adults, which is healthy coping skills, good social relationships. I'm gonna shut up in a minute, let you come back here. But then you get people that are experimenting, trying, you know, so you wanna have healthy alternatives. Like, instead of doing drugs, can you have dances where there are no drugs? Can you have drop-in places for teens to hang out where they can deal with the stress and just have fun in a non-drug oriented environment? Can you have good role models? Can you have Boy Scouts? But then once people start taking drugs, then you need intervention and you need to be able to provide treatment, recovery. They go to jail. There should be programs from day one when a person gets in jail to support them and to help them leave prison equipped to have a healthy adult life, you know, and then when they're released, you can't assume that they're going to be fine. You've got to build in your recovery supports, and, you know, it goes on and on. And you want to help prevent relapse. Well, how do you do that? Well, you have friendships, you have churches, you have 12-step groups, you have support groups, you have, and you encourage people to ask for help. You encourage people to talk. You encourage people to listen, you know, and it may be a small thing that just blows up unexpectedly. You have crisis hotlines. We do have now a 998 number that anybody can dial anywhere in the United States for suicide help. So that and 211 are also essential numbers to remember, because there are ways to get help if people are too discouraged, too down, too scared, too overwhelmed, too depressed, too angry. They need someone with them to help them make that step. And all of us need someone to help us take next steps.
Do you two see a, because I know we talked about this last week with Mike Piper and Sean Graham, you know, back when I was younger, 2 years ago, yeah, he's up on me, Reed. Anyway, we were talking about back in the day, the big thing, women wanted to be nurses, guys wanted to be police officers and firemen. But there's a turn away from all the positive. I mean, Wendy, you and I talked about the Neighborhood Youth Academy, and I'm not sure what happened, but there was, I could not get the people together to put it on this year. But the Neighborhood Youth Academy, we brought in, Reed, I don't know if you're familiar with it or not, but it's a program that was started at the Pink Church with Mother Marjorie. very wonderful. I love that woman. She is just an amazing individual. And we sat down one time and we were discussing her. She said, you know, what really got her into this? This little boy walked up and he was standing there. They were doing some work in the garden and he was just standing there, and Mother Marjorie looked at him. She said, can I help you? And he was hungry. And that just really, really touched her. So she says, what can we do? Well, I said, well, actually Rick did. I think the Neighborhood Youth Academy logo was actually Rick's idea. I'm not going to say me. I think we kind of worked on it together, but it was Neighborhood Youth Academy. And it's a program designed for kids to see police, fire, EMS, military, magistrates in a positive light, not showing up at their house. And it worked really well. The kids, I still see the kids that I had in the first Neighborhood Youth Academy, and they come up and give me hugs. They remember me because I think I had a positive effect on them, because, I mean, we treated them with such respect, and they didn't know what to do with themselves. But, you know, every day at 911, we answer the phone, we hear people doing CPR, somebody's unresponsive from a drug overdose, they're doing CPR. You talk about something that is, I mean, it's traumatic, because you're sitting there, you're listening to mom or sister or wife or husband, their loved one. You know, I mean, Narcan is a good idea, but, you know, sometimes it just gets to the point where these people, it becomes a thing for them. But again, I'm so looking forward, and I wish I was there, and I hope you guys are able to get me some literature on Thursday nights, because I was going to be there. And like I said, unfortunately, so let me think here, where are we going to go now?
Bob, if that's okay, I'll respond to kind of what you're mentioning about that academy, where you try to lift up the elected officials in the positive resources and services in the community in a positive light. Okay. So that the kids respected them, revered them, and maybe would follow that example. So there's an Icelandic model of prevention, of youth prevention, a study and an experiment done in the country of Iceland, where the children in those school systems, in those communities, they were made sure that they participated every evening, every week, and basically every hour of the day in some kind of positive, structured, extracurricular, recreational activity. And what they saw as they studied these youth over time, that the substance use, tobacco use, alcohol use, went to the floor. You're looking at like 85 to 90% success rate in that community over just a year or two period. And the solution for them was keep these kids engaged, involved in a family setting, in a communal setting, where the focus is health, the focus is recreation, the focus is structure, skill development. Development is an individual character. So I think if you apply that to locally, we are really in a mess. You talk mm-hmm. about the family structure, you know, we've got a divorce rate that's over 50%. So we have to recognize that the family structure is a barrier, because kids may not have access to those same type of programs in the community, be able to get to and from, because they're in essentially a broken home. And what are we consuming with our media? Now, I'm not planning to take down big media, but I think as adults, we have to be intentional about what do we consume ourselves? Because when youth see what we consume, they're going to model that. And if they're consuming, you know, rap, hip hop music that's promoting dealing drugs, victimizing women, if we're consuming unhealthy things in general, the kids are going to pick up on that. So I think as adults and as a community, we need to A, make it okay to talk about these things, whether it's addiction, suicide, our mental health, our own poor choices. We need to B, set the healthiest example we can with our own choices, with the content we consume, the choices we make. And I believe over time that in itself can pay off. So it's important that we look at what are we feeding our kids? What are we feeding ourselves? Because we can't just say, well, the kids don't need to be listening to that or watching that and filter it out and block it out and expect things to change. But I think we can set a healthy example, and that, you know, over time will pay off.
I always told my girls that, you know, when they became moms, children live what they learn. And I think that's a big statement. They live what they learn. If they live hatred. And by the way, we're getting a bunch of comments from different people. Dominic Curl prevention in schools, all the above for you, Wendy Tuck, 1-800-1844-HELP for West Virginia. Brandy Best says we need to get more for the youth to be involved in. Yes, we do. That is a must. We have to get these kids engaged. And that's what I was talking about with the youth centers, where they can come in and get away from that environment. They can come in and talk to people, have fun. It's like the Boys and Girls Club, but, you know, kind of on a different level, because not everybody lives within the realm of the Boys and Girls Club. They can't always get there. So, you know, I know I had a big meeting, it's been 3 years ago, a bunch of community people showed up, and we were discussing the youth centers, and everybody wanted to do it, but it just kind of went away because everybody got tied up on other stuff. But I'm hoping what happens is after Thursday that we don't let that go. You know what I mean? We do not let that go. We continue on with the spirit of what's going to happen Thursday night. We need to continue on with that. And because, you know, I've always said, you know, people are right. It does take a village to raise a child sometimes, you know what I mean? And sometimes we have to step in and say, you know what, let me help. Let me, you know, and that's why here at the Bobcast, and this is exact reason why Rick and I are doing this, A, to get people involved in the community, B, to bring positive, like you and Reed, positive people who are making an impact on this community. We're going to have a bunch more. We're starting right now to schedule for August. And afterwards, Reed, after Thursday, sometime maybe in the next couple, 3 weeks, I'd love to have you back on and we can discuss that. Wendy, you too. I love having you guys on. And I'm finally glad that you got that taken care of. But, you know, I really think that this is a major problem, not just for us, but around the country. I mean, it's becoming it's becoming the downfall, so to speak. You know, I told my wife, we talk about it, and I said, I'm afraid for my grandkids as kids, because we don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah. One thing I think is so important is for us to look at ourselves and to look at where we have the courage to face our own problems honestly, with courage. You know, some drugs are legal and some drugs are illegal. And, you know, you have alcohol has been illegal at some times and legal other times. Pot is legal some places and not legal places. Cocaine used to be in our Coca-Cola, you know, like there's drugs or painkillers. Drugs make you feel better. Drugs heal you. Some drugs cause harm. So people take drugs, whether legal or illegal, for lots of different reasons. And I think what we want to do as adults is look at our courage, our fear, our pain. What are we dealing with courageously, openly? Where are we hiding? Where are we avoiding our own disasters, for lack of a better word? I mean, how many of us go home and get a good drink after a hard day at work, right?
Right.
How many of us go shopping and say, oh, it's just retail therapy? Like, you know, the kids see us taking shortcuts to feeling better. And, you know, anything in moderation is probably not harmful. I mean, like, but except the fentanyl once is right. Harmful.
What
we as adults can do is model openness. And I am really struggling with XYZ with my kids or my parents or whoever. I'm really sad. I'm really mad. I'm really frustrated. And this is how I'm going to cope with it. And we set those models every single day. And even if we don't think anybody's watching, they are, you know, and they see right. How we're coping with our lives. And we can be that encouragement to other kids and other our peers as well, you know, to say, hey, you might not need to get so drunk tonight. You know, why don't you come over and let's watch a movie? So we can do those things for each other. And exactly. It's not just them it's also us, you know, that we are building strength, we are building courage. That's just what I'd like to say, is that we're kind of all in this together. I mean, life is painful and hard, and we can all lift each other up.
What do you think, Reed, about, and we discussed this last week with Mike Pfeiffer and Sean Graham, the QRTs, quick response teams. I mean, good idea. But I'm not sure. Do we have them now?
Yes.
In Wood County?
I know
Wood County does.
To my knowledge, Westbrook Health Services managed Wood Counties, and the Middle Ohio Valley Health Department manages it in the other six counties, Roan, Calhoun, Pleasants, Wirt, Jackson, I believe, or maybe Jackson's separate. So all those rural counties, the Middle Ohio Valley Health Department manages. Wood County's Westbrook. And we do have them. And I worked at Westbrook for 6 months as a youth recovery coach. And I'll be honest, it's the first time I'd ever seen any model like that. It seemed very effective. I mean, when you go the next day after somebody overdosed and knock at the address they left with EMS, you can expect, like, maybe you're not going to make a radical difference that day in that person's life, if they're even lucky enough to be at that same place. But that outreach in the communities, dropping off those business cards, people, you know, in those communities, seeing people show up, you know, the police car comes with them, but the people come separate, and the people come with lived experience, and the people come because they care. They're working that job because they want to make a difference, not a bunch of money. And I've seen a lot of people be saved through the QRT program. Sure, we've lost a lot of people, but we've lost a lot less because of the QRT. So I think they do good work.
I'm glad. I said I wasn't sure about Wood County. I did know about Wood County has them. And, but, you know, I've always said, you know, how you handle a situation will ultimately affect the outcome, either good or bad or otherwise. I started a program many years ago called Working by the Code, CODE, and it's a program that I worked on. And it, I just kind of teach about confidence in yourself. It's mainly for the security field. I've been in it for 25 plus years, but you know, it's just something that we need to come up with. And like I said, I hope after Thursday we can continue this talk, this conversation. And there's so many things going on, you know, there's so many positive things happening. And that's what I want to focus on, guys, that I want to focus on positives. You know, I don't want to say, well, you know, that guy's a druggie. Okay, whatever. You know, okay, what can we do? You know, let's make this turn this negative into a positive. And let's show everybody what, you know, that there is positive things going on in the Middle Ohio Valley. Facebook has become quite the, and I'm on Facebook all the time because of my family, but Facebook has become quite the anti-establishment for different things. You know, oh, this guy did this and this officer did that and this person did that. Okay. All right. I understand that, you know. Tess says hi, Ray. I didn't know if you could see it or not.
Hi, Tess. Thanks for joining.
Yeah. we're getting a lot of good conversation today about this, and that's great. And I hope that everybody shows up Thursday night and Reed makes the and Wendy and makes this a very positive community outreach thing that we can, like I said, continue to do. And because anything to help, we're not going to eradicate drugs. I mean, our officers are trying, but as long as things are going on where they're going on, you know, and the southern borders and stuff like that. And I'm not getting into all the negativity because that's not what I'm about. But, you know, the things that are going on, that stuff's coming in and it is scary. And, you know, I thank God I've got three granddaughters. One's in college and two are in high school. And I thank God that they didn't, you know, participate in that stuff. And as far as me, you know, I my big thing was, and I've mentioned this before on a past show, I didn't want to have to look my mom in the face. You know what I mean? Because I know what would happen. My mother would, the look on my mother's face would devastate me. And I didn't want to have to face my grandfather. My grandfather was more of my dad, but I didn't want to face my grandfather. My grandfather was a wonderful, smart man, and having to face him. So, we're going to have the conversation about turning things around and making things better for everybody involved. And, you know, if the Bobcast can do anything, and I mean anything, we're here, at, you know, you guys, Reed, is there anything you want to say, sir? Is there anything that, that we haven't talked about that you'd like to, you know, run with? We still got plenty of time.
There's a few things I'd like to touch on. When we talk about social media, you know, Rick started off mentioning that 20% is around the number we're looking at of kids that have expressed thoughts about suicide. And it's likely higher because not everybody responds honestly on surveys. And if you look at technology, I mean, it's easy to attribute some of those negative mental health aspects to the use of technology and social media. But if you look at it as a tool and we look at it, you know, how much time we're spending on it already, how can we use social media to leverage time to do? Can we post all the things that are going on in the community regularly, like the Bobcast, like all the events, you know, at the Arts Center, or the YMCA, or the Boys and Girls Club? Can we be intentional? Because I scroll through my feed sometimes and I see this person got married or this person, you know, with the new job, and all that's great. But how often do you see the way people genuinely feel? I woke up today and didn't feel like living, or I woke up and thought about using today, or I probably had too many beers last night after work and I'm kind of embarrassed about my choices lately. Can we use social media to be transparent about our struggles instead of it being a facade? And does that have a positive impact on our community? Personally, from my experience over the past 2 years, using it when I'm struggling as well as when I'm doing well has had a positive impact, because I have had dozens and dozens of people reach out to me privately and say, thank you for being transparent about your struggles. I was in a difficult place and I wasn't sure I was going to make it, but that let me know that it was okay to be in that place. Thank you for being, you know, loud about your recovery, being upfront about your experiences. Now I feel like I'm not a fraud. I'm not a bad person. I shouldn't be ashamed about my past. So I think it's important we all do that in our own respects to our own experiences, so we empower and lift up people that have similar experiences. I want to mention that on August 20th, the Boys and Girls Club is having their annual fundraiser inside the huddle with Tony Caridi. When you ask, you know, what can the community do to help? Support the existing programs. Donate a little bit of money if you have it. Donate a little bit of time if you have it. You know, I don't have a real strong family network. I've got some extended family that's really supportive and a great mentor. So when I came home from prison 2 years ago, part of my reentry plan was volunteering. And I just said yes to everything. I got involved at North Parkersburg Baptist Church. I got involved in every group I could. And within 2 years, I ended up on 8 different boards of directors with more on my schedule that I could keep up with. But it was saying yes to all those opportunities, realizing that I could be useful as a community member, that led me to believe that I can make a difference. I mean, me and Wendy have been involved in more neighborhood cleanups or meetings or conversations with people just to try and do something, right? We don't have all the answers. We just want to do something. And I encourage people to get excited about their community, right? Because if you're not excited about it, it's not happening. Exactly. Whatever you can see happen, it's right out your front door. We got the Belpre mural project done in just a couple months. And so
that is amazing.
I mean, I could not be more proud of the Belpre community coming together and doing something like that that's lifted up the whole neighborhood. So
that's that was an amazing piece of work that you guys did. I was thoroughly impressed that we showed that on the podcast.
Oh, did you? Thank you.
right after it was done, I believe it was, wasn't it, Rick?
Yeah. Same week. Yeah.
Same week it was done. We put it on the Bobcast because it just amazed us. And the thing about this is, Rick and I doing this is we learned so much that we didn't know before. And so, you know, we try to stay positive. Every once in a while we'll mention something, but you know, we want to make a positive impact on people's lives in the community. And we want people to, Rick and I started the Wood County Volunteer Coalition. We have a page, and that Wood County Volunteer Coalition is a program to match those who want to volunteer with those who need volunteers. So, you know, I'm going to plug that. Go to the Wood County Volunteer Coalition webpage. All these people need help. I mean, if you just got a couple hours a week, that's a couple hours a week that these people are going to, need, you know, that they appreciate that. You know, we've talked to several people here on the Bobcast, and it's just amazing the work that's being done that I had no idea about. You know, I was on Circle's board for a little bit, but my schedule got so whacked, I could not keep up with anything. So, you know, between work and city council and everything else, but you know, I'm proud of you guys. I appreciate you guys. I really appreciate you bringing that to Wood County, to Parkersburg, and opening up the conversation. And again, I do hope, guys, that we can move on with it and keep the conversation rolling. You know, I'm not sure what we can do long-term, short-term, maybe, you know, we can do some things, but, and then move into a long-term solution and try to come up with some ideas. You know, Wendy Tuck, and I'm going to say this, Wendy Tuck is one of the hardest working people. Absolutely. Always involved in something in this community. And that's awesome, because she comes in, she'll say something, and I'm like, now that's just too cool. At council meeting, she'll say, I was here, and I'm like, that's too cool, Wendy, because she really, really cares. And we appreciate that, Wendy, very much. You're just an awesome individual, and I want you to understand that. That's what I think of you. You are an awesome individual. And
well, people are pretty fascinating, you know, and I find that I think one thing we can never, ever, ever underestimate is being kind and being curious. Like when we're tempted to be judgmental or to look down at somebody, just to go, well, I might not do that, but I don't know what I would do if I was in their shoes. Like half my neighborhood, I have no idea how they cope with their stuff. I mean, they are brave and competent beyond my wildest imagination, you know, and they're, you know, to remember that every single person is somebody's little boy, somebody's little girl, somebody's grandkid, you know, like, I don't, exactly. I mean, it's a big complex problem, but it's also like every single encounter, be kind, you know, be respectful, be notice people, treat them like a human being. And you can never underestimate that ever. Because sometimes you don't feel like you're worth anything, like you're not worth saving. Like I tell you, I bet every single person who receives Narcan has thought, just let me die. Just let my life be over. I'm done. And when they hear that from other people, or they say, well, you know, why do we keep doing this? But sometimes I have never heard anybody say, you matter, live for me, you know, live for me. I want you here. I care about you. I want you here. And that may be the thing that turns around. I mean, every one of us have been in tough spots where that little bit of encouragement makes all the difference in the world. So yes, it is complicated and complex, but it's also very, very simple. Like the person in front of you, look at them, listen to them, see them as a human being, you know, and treat them with kindness and respect. I just think we can't ever underestimate that. And like you say, Bob, people are doing tremendous things. And sometimes all you do is come in behind them, you know, and go, hey, I'm going to give you my $2. I'm going to, that's Reed asked me to talk at the city park at his run. And that's how we met. You know, it's just, it's crazy. Like, you know, you get out there and you talk to people and you find out what's going on. And like you say, Bob, there's really good stuff. And we can, if we're out of ideas, half my brilliance is from other people. I'll just tell you, I don't have all those ideas. I listen a lot, you know.
That's and fine, but you bring them out in a positive way. You always bring them out in a positive way.
Not all me.
You know, but, go ahead, Reed.
It's just amazing how profound and simple a principle it is that Wendy's talking about, of being kind and spreading kindness. And I have a story to share. It's a short one. I've given a lot of talks at local civic organizations and elsewhere. And I often get asked, you know, what do we do, whether it's substance use or the homeless problem? And my mentors even asked me this, if you had the opportunity to be before council and they asked you for like one solution to fix this problem, what would it be, Reed? And I said, well, I don't really know for one answer. So I asked Lou Ortenzio, he's the director of the Clarksburg Mission, which I spent many months at when I was younger and homeless. And that place had a positive impact in my life. And I said, Lou, what would your answer be, you know, if you had one answer to give before an entity that wanted to help this problem? He said, well, I don't really know what my one answer would be, but I've got a story of a successful businessman who was in Clarksburg for a long time, did a lot of great works, was very wealthy. And at the end of the time, he felt like he hadn't fulfilled his purpose or made the difference he wanted to. So after he retired from business, he went around Clarksburg, West Virginia, and he introduced himself and he got to know every homeless person that lived on those streets that he could, and he connected with them and he built relationships with them. So when we talk about what can we do to care for the youth in our community, if we can be more concerned about connecting with them and getting to know them in any manner we interact with them, if we can care about connecting with the people next door to us, at the store with us, down the street from us, you really can't measure the impact it's going to have, because throwing money at it or building a program or developing a plan can only go so far if there's no humanity at the basis of it. And I think that's what Wendy's talking about. And I think it matters.
That is a smart comment. That is a very good comment. I agree 100% with that. So, Wendy, do you have anything else you'd like to add before we close for the night?
Don't be afraid of the truth. I mean, that's always my model is, you know, like, whatever is real, whatever is true, just admit it. I mean, sometimes you feel, you know, like an idiot or ashamed, but, you know, what do they say? An ugly truth is better than a beautiful lie. But so many times we get into trouble by trying to cover up or hide or pretend or lie. And it just doesn't work. I mean, it just adds up and you feel worse and you feel powerless and then you get into this spiral. But if you can find one trusted person, or even if in your journal, you never, ever lie to yourself, like just face yourself, or, you know, in 12 steps, they say, you know, confess to God and one other human being, or one trustworthy person. And just the truth is life hurts and life is beautiful and complex, you know, so there's not I don't know that there's a right or wrong answer, but I guess I would just say, what's the truth? What's really going on here? And what,
you know,
can
they
I
always
do?
Say that the truth will set you free. And that's,
I believe that.
It has. Beyond words, guys. It has.
Reed, is there anything you'd like to say, sir, before we close out for the evening?
Just a heartfelt thank you to you and Rick and Wendy. I just want you to know how much it means to me, just a little over a year after I first met you, to be on the Bobcast to share our experiences and trying to build a better MOV. It's a pleasure. Yeah.
That's what the show is all about, is building a better MOV and bringing the positives out to it. And Tessa, you're right. Shine your lights. You know, come on, you know, be that beacon that people can, of hope that people can look to and say, that right there is why I want to go on, you know. And so, Reed, thank you. You're a very smart individual. Wendy, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate you both very much. Rick, anything you'd like to say before we close out tonight, sir?
Yeah, but I don't want to be on here another half an hour. A long time ago, about 45 minutes ago, Wendy mentioned youth activities, and that just started my head spinning. I grew up in the 50s. I mean, I'm that old. I really am. You can't tell by looking at me, but I grew up in the 50s. And I got to think, when she was talking, I was thinking about all the people, all the adults in my life that worked so hard to make me know that I was worth something. I got into the Boy Scouts when I was 6 years old. I joined the Cubs. I stayed in the Boy Scouts until I was 20 years old and went into the service. I had my youth group at church on every Wednesday night. I had Boy Scouts every Thursday night. I had, as I was growing up, I got into music. When I was in high school, I was in the band for 2 years. I was in the orchestra for 2 years. And the orchestra conductor, or the orchestra teacher at my school, just happened to be the choir director at my church. And his entire thing was making kids who made noise on instruments to make them feel like they were accomplished musicians, to make them feel like they were worth something. And I think that's what's missing in our entire society that I see now, that we had in the 50s, we don't have now. Everybody worked so hard to make everybody else feel like they were absolutely worth something, you know, a real needed human being, somebody who needed to be in part of our society. And I just hate that we don't see that anymore.
Well, okay. I appreciate you all very much. Rick, thanks a lot for that one, sir. We've come to the end of the Bobcast for this week. We thank you all very much for being a part of it and listening to us and your great comments. We had so many comments. That's amazing. Please send your questions, comments, and suggestions to us at comments@thebobcast.net. so we can discuss them on the podcast. And don't forget to like and follow us on Facebook and Twitter and subscribe to our YouTube channel at the Bobcast MOV. And so in 30 minutes, probably in about 30 minutes or so, maybe a little bit longer since we've had a lot going on, probably about an hour and a half, Rick, you'll be
probably about an hour for it to render.
We will be uploaded to YouTube. Go on there, watch it, click subscribe, and just we need to get this out here. This is something Rick and I are very passionate about. So we're going to say goodnight. And as always, remember this: those who are always looking down never see the rainbow or silver linings. So keep looking up, everybody, and keep looking forward and never give up. Thank you guys very much for being here. Have a wonderful evening. Mr. Sawyer, as always, I'll call you, sir.
Absolutely. Good night, everybody.
You all have a great
night. Thank you, Bob. Thank you, Rick. Thank you so much.